Derek Varia, 18-year Army veteran, hunter, fisherman, bushcrafter, survivalist. I like to sum up all these skills with one word, and that's woodsman. I think you need to be well-versed in all of the skills that you're going to need to make it out here. So I'll be attempting to survive alone, no camera crew, and only what I have on my back for up to a year. We're right in the middle of the Mountain Lakes region. Resources should be plentiful. Knowing how to get them is the key. So here I am, alone, dropped off on an old logging road of sorts. So I'm just gonna take a minute here and collect my thoughts, come up with a game plan. I pretty much know what I need to do, but I just wanna relax, get more mentally prepared for this. You know, I think there's a certain romance to doing something like this. You know, it's appealing to a lot of people, outdoors type people, of course. But a lot of people, I think, tend to think about it as coming out here and, you know, living off the land. I tend to think of it a little different, or try to anyway. Living off the land kind of denotes a certain parasitic relationship, which obviously isn't good. So in order to make it out here for a year, you kind of got to live with the land and incorporate yourself into nature's rhythm. You'll see a lot more things. If I come stumbling down this logging road like a typical hiker, I'm not gonna see anything, at least in the way of wild game. And that's one of the main resources that I'm gonna have to find out here and get on top of, you know, in order to make it. So this isn't a sprint, it's more of a marathon. I need to take my time, do things right, kind of read the landscape and go with it all. So we're gonna leave the pack here for a second, take a quick walk around my immediate area, see if there's anything in the way of resources. Right now the weather's pretty good. It's been raining, to my knowledge, off and on for the past 12, 14 hours. So everything out here is pretty wet. But then again, we're here in the mountains, you know, the weather can change in a matter of minutes. And you could have a storm come out clear over the top of the mountain. You're not gonna know that till it's right on you. So staying dry is gonna be key, obviously. Maintaining my body's core temperature is gonna be of the utmost importance. And this isn't your typical 72-hour scenario where I get rescued at the end or magically find my way out. You know, I'm trying to be here. I'm trying to live out here for up to a year. Now this is a good sign right here. A couple trees. I just noticed this walking back to my pack here. This is from a deer, a buck to be particular, where he's rubbed the tree with his horns. And I know for a fact that's a deer because I confirm it multiple ways. One, I've got the classic deer rub here on the tree, but and then I confirm that with something else on the ground just to be positive, because that could also be a
So here's my ground confirmation by the way of scat. That's deer scat. And then we have a little bit more. Right there.
And though it's not hunting season, that's a pretty good find. Again, just tells me that I can't rule this area totally out. Food is obviously going to be very important. An animal that big, I probably don't want to shoot right away unless I absolutely needed it. But come winter time here in a couple months, that's exactly the type of food I'm going to need. So we'll keep this area in mind. Hopefully we don't have to travel too far to where we can, you know, find a spot that's full of resources. And by that I mean, you know, proper trees and ways to get firewood again without spending too much calories having to cut it down
this area would do that. But I need other things. I need plants for, you know, to eat wild edibles. I need medicinal type plants because I only have minimal stuff with me, you know, in the way of medicine and stuff like that. At some point here, within the next couple months, I'm gonna have to build a pretty permanent shelter if I plan on making it through the winter. So those are the type of resources that I'm looking for to go along with, you know, the animals that are gonna help feed me. A water source is obviously critical for me. It's just as critical for the animals, and that's a good place to start off when you're looking to do any type of hunting, obviously fishing and trapping. So we definitely need to find a water source. Another classic deer rib within 30 yards.
All right, before we head off here, come across another really good resource. Wintergreen tea berry. It usually grows in acidic type ground. Oh, there's a lot of pines here. Usually out in the open somewhere, but not always. And the classic way to identify this plant,
you just break a leaf off, kind of macerate it in your fingers like this, and then smell it. It smells exactly like wintergreen. So again, it's a wild edible. It grows little orangish, almost red type berries. Even those, if you pick, kind of squeeze it in your finger, it's got that sweet smell to it, wintergreeny smell to it. Very good to eat. Also, this is a medicinal plant. So you can take the leaves of these, make them into a tea, and it's very good, you know, for cold and flu type symptoms. So it's a good find. A good hunting tip I learned, could go for a lot of things. Well, I learned from an elder up in Maine when I was seeking more knowledge. You know, like I said earlier, your typical backpacker will walk through these woods, and if he's stumbling in a rush, got somewhere to go, he's probably not going to see any wildlife. You can read the landscape off of bird language. And typically, they'll definitely know you're coming. They react to stimuli and not, you know, everything else. Their brains don't process stuff like we do. So they know you're coming. You'll see them hook up to a branch, you know, if you're being careful. And they know you're there. And if you look intimidating or out here like you're hunting, they sense that because their lives depend on it. So if you make them sound their bird alarm, you know, the deer that was 50 yards up the trail is already moving out, and you'll never see him, nor the bear. So they'll know for up to 3 full minutes that you've been coming, and you'll never see him. So again, taking your time, looking around, using your wide field of vision, you know, being careful not to snap branches, and just being a klutz will benefit you greatly. So I'm coming to a small clearing here, which is usually good for certain type plants too. A lot of plants grow on edges of things, edges of fields, edges of water, stuff like that. So that's a good place to look for wild edibles and medicinals as well. So we're gonna scout this out, see if we can find anything. So there wasn't much in the field, but still very early here up in the mountains of New Hampshire. Winter basically just ended two and a half weeks ago. This whole ground was covered in snow, so it's gonna take a little bit before all your, you know, edible plants, medicinal plants start coming up, but it's in the early stages of that now. I'm down in some marshy slash swampy area right now. I can see a bunch of fiddlehead ferns all over the place, so there's some edibles.
Wild rhubarb. Are you kidding me right now? You know, again, winter kind of just ended here up in the northeast. So this stuff's just starting to come up. It's still got a lot way to go. It's definitely edible right now. And that's some good eating right there. I'm probably going to have to steal a little piece just because.
Salad, eat it raw. If I had some sugar right now, man, oh man. But it's pretty much got, you know, a half round stalk, obviously the reddish tint to it, and then on one side it's got a classic U groove to it, and that's how I'm able to identify it. Not to mention, if I just break a piece off and smell it, that's some good stuff. So again, we're, if I had to guess, probably a couple football fields length away from where we first started. And we've already discovered quite a bit of resources here. The one that we haven't found yet, which is one of the most important, is gonna be water. So we still gotta continue on. Hopefully I don't have to get too far away from this area because it's looking pretty good. There's a lot of birch trees, lots of pines, and that's going to be key for me to affect fire. So hopefully we can find what we're looking for here shortly. Well, been hiking around for quite a while. Finally found a water source, which is good. I've been taking multiple breaks along the way, and I've drank in most of my water, so couldn't be happier right now. So I'm gonna drop my pack here. I'm thinking this is a good spot where I'm at to set up camp. Pretty open right here, stand up pines mixed with some hardwoods. Some of the things I'm looking for, where I'm going to set up my camp, is first thing I look for is any widow makers or something that's going to fall and make me not be able to go home to my wife. So the area right here looks pretty good for that. After that, I don't want the lowest ground. Cold air tends to sink anyways. They're going to be the colder spots. And I don't want the highest ground because I don't want all that wind on me either. So I'm looking for middle ground, something that's not going to flood out on me. And, you know, try to get the least exposure to the elements as possible and as be as safe as possible. So, again, this looks like a good spot. So I'm going to catch my breath here, dig some stuff out of my pack, and we'll take a walk about 50 yards off to my right and show you what I found for water. Yeah, I gotta be careful walking around with this calorie tick on my back for as long as I have. A little warm right now. I haven't sweat too bad, which is good, but you definitely want to stay clear of stuff like that. You know, I think it was right around the 40 degree mark today, but had I keep pushing myself, not taking my time, build up a good sweat, you know, hypothermia right around the corner. Just about up. out there. A couple more sips left. We'll get some water while we're down there. We're checking out the water situation.
You know, generally speaking, up here in the mountains, you can find a lot of little streams like this. And in some cases, it's just mountain runoff. I don't know that that's the case or not here, if this stream is always here. But some things I need to think about are, is this going to be a good spot still come wintertime? This is probably going to get froze over. It's very shallow, so it doesn't appear to have any fish in it, at least not right here. As the summer moves on, it may have frogs and crayfish and stuff like that, which is really good. Lower chain food sources are always good, and this is exactly where you find them, at the water's edge. Another thing to think about, is in an extreme emergency, if I had to, I'd probably just go ahead and drink this water. But being out here for a year, that's the last thing I want to do. So wherever this is coming from, which obviously I don't know yet, I could walk upstream and try to figure that out. But a lot of this water is getting filtered down as it comes. There's plenty of rocks in here. I can see some smaller rocks in the bottom. We got moss and leaves and things like that. And it's moving water. It's not standing still. So it's not stagnant. So again, if I had to, in an extreme emergency, rather than die of dehydration, I'd just go ahead and drink this stuff. But again, I'm going to be out here for up to a year. So I need to go ahead and disinfect my water.
We got a container full of water here.
Before we drink that, we obviously have to disinfect it. So there's numerous ways you could do that. I can get all creative and make a primitive type filter out here. And that's not gonna do a whole lot for me other than get out some particulates. To truly disinfect that, the only way to do that and disinfect it 100% is to boil that water. So that means we need fire. It's getting late in the day. I'm not sure exactly what time it is. I popped it out of a watch because I think at this point, you know, if you're going to be out here for a year, you know, woodsmen of days past, you know, typically the 18th century time frame, which I've done quite a bit of research on, those folks didn't live by the minute or the hour or the day. They lived by the season, and that's how they kept track of time. You know, what was going on in what particular season, what resources were available when, and that's kind of how they did things. So I'm going to try to do the same. So with that said, I think it's about time that I actually go ahead and set up camp. I got to gather firewood yet to get a fire going. So I'm going to go ahead and do that first, I think. Come back, start setting up my shelter, and I will go from there. If you notice, there's quite a bit of birch trees around me, quite a bit of pine, as I mentioned earlier. That's key factor for fire up here in the Northeast. You know, if you can't get a fire going with that, pretty much you ain't trying. We're not gonna go the easy route this time, seeing it's day one and I'm still pretty fresh. Haven't spent a whole bunch of calories to this point. This may not be where I end up staying for the duration, but it's gonna be here for the night anyway, and possibly a few days at least, so I can get a good feel for what's going on in the area. So I found what I believe to be horseweed. It's a big stock plant, typically has a lot of leaves on it. This is obviously from last year. They generally have a pithy type stock, which is good for certain things. So we're gonna go ahead and try to get a hand drill fire going here shortly. But first we gotta go collect our tinder and kindling. You know, birch bark has a oil in it called betulin, which is highly combustible, which makes this my prime tinder up in the Northeast. You know, some people prefer different things. This is my go-to. If I absolutely have to get a fire going, this is the stuff right here. It'll take a spark from a ferro rod. Open flame, obviously, very easy, even when it's wet.
know, by peeling the bark off like this, you're not going to hurt the tree any. It's kind of shedding its outer layer anyways as it's growing. What you don't want to do is cut into this with your knife or an axe or something like that and totally wring this tree out. At that point, you know, then you're killing it. So be a good steward of the woods. Get what you need in a respectful manner. Don't take everything. Nah, that's your way of giving back to the forest. That's providing for you. So we have some birch bark for our tinder. Now we need some kindling. And our kindling needs to be some small stuff. Generally, again, up here, pine is my go-to. You want all the dead small stuff that's still on the tree hanging up high, especially, you know, over the course of last night and this morning, it's been raining on and off here. So anything on the ground at this point is going to be wet. So you want the stuff up high that snaps just like that when you get it. And that's going to do you a lot of good. Now this stuff, you're going to need a whole bunch of it. So I'm going to keep collecting this. We'll make a pile at camp. Set up our tarp and start preparing for tonight. What I've chosen for my shelter is an oilcloth tarp. Again, going back to the folks from the 18th century, this was their preferred carry. Mainly, that's all they had, but it worked for them. So the difference between this and an ultralight, you know, backpacker type Silnai tarp is obviously this is going to take sparks from my fire a lot better than a Silnai tarp. So I'm not going to get all the burn holes and chance getting wet.
So the reason I set my topper up the way I did, and this is typically how I do it more often than not, but I get sort of a rain fly over the top front section of it, just in case the wind changes during the night when I'm sleeping and the rain comes from a different direction. It offers me more protection than just your straight lean-to type design. I've also cupped it in the back because I don't need such a big area. It's not too cold right now, but all I need is a small fire out here. The heat will radiate into this and keep me toasty warm, you know, if the blankets ain't enough by chance. So try to keep it small and compact instead of, you know, this big monstrosity where all the wind's coming in and out. You notice I have a tree at where my head's gonna be.
And that'll offer me a little bit more protection up by my head, you know, in the way of some predator animal that may walk into camp
also
tonight.
I've set this up in a way where the wind is kind of blowing from your back towards me at an angle. So I could have put my top the other way and totally blocked the wind. But then on the other side of things, any wind that's coming around is taking the heat from my fire away from me. So I want the wind, you know, to help me to a point and help blow the heat into my shelter, but I don't want it blowing straight in and trapping any smoke that may come with it. So it's kind of at an angle away from this side where my head's gonna be and blowing out towards my feet. So this is, again, typically how I like to set up my tarp shelter.
All right,
so I've taken a piece of that horseweed that we found, cut a small, just a small chunk of eastern white pine, just a little slab of that, nothing special. So now what I need to do is get a little divot started in here for the piece of horseweed. And try it right here. Finish that with my Swiss Army knife. Round it out a little better. Alright, so I got a little divot that'll be where this spins inside. Once we get that going, I'm gonna have to cut a little notch in the front of this board to allow the dust to fall in to create my ember. Hopefully. So we'll give this a few spins. All right, smoking, good sign. Some dark dust, that's also a good sign. I'm gonna set that off to the side for a second and cut our notch. I'm gonna use the saw on my Swiss Army knife for that. Thank you.
don't want to do is cut myself. Finish that with the knife. Just clean out any of that stuff inside there that's jagged. Hopefully that's gonna do it.
Alright, so the next thing we need to make sure we have is our bird's nest. If you remember that birch bark that we grabbed, we're just going to process this up, and it's just a matter of macerating it, creating fine fibers. So when I put the ember in there, it'll combust. Tuck that back into my fire lay over here, because I don't have a big enough bird's nest to hold in my hand and blow the flame. Hopefully that's gonna be all right. Now it's smoking, but I need to fill that hole with dust before it's ever gonna do anything for me. So I'm not getting too crazy with it yet. Really want to do that. Should have a coal. Shouldn't say should. We do have a coal. So, horse weed, eastern white pine, I'm sorry. I don't want to lose that. Dump that into a bird's nest over here. Blew it right out. That's not a good thing. So you know, that's the thing with perimeter fire. I mean, I got actually very lucky. I mean, I kind of know what to look for. I've done this before, obviously, but first time go, made the set, and I got a cull, but the way I did it, my bird's nest wasn't properly built. I said that earlier, it wasn't big enough to where I can hold it in my hand, so that was one downfall. And I'm thinking it wasn't processed enough either, so I ended up just blowing that small cull I had out. And you're gonna have typically a small cull when you're using a hand drill, so we're not giving up. Time. I'm gonna try that one again. Added a little cedar bark to my birch bark, gives me a little something to hold, and we're gonna try it that way this time. So I'm gonna set that off to the side, get our set back, try this one more time. I still got a little ember right inside that notch, if you can see that. Try to flip that out of there. Put that into our bundle here. We should be able to boil our water. You know, and obviously that wasn't the easy way to do things, but primitive skills are very important to know. They're important to practice in the event that that's your only option. So, chose to do primitive fire. One, because I still have the calories to do that. I didn't waste too many today. And at the same time, I've conserved resources that I have. In that my preferred method of starting a fire, at least when I'm out doing this type of thing, is with a ferro rod or my lighter, you know, big lighter. But that thing runs out, and you can't depend solely on a ferro rod. So. Just keep the this fire going now. Shouldn't be too hard to do. I got some big firewood just over here, you can see. Still got some small stuff, and all around me there's nothing but down trees. Again, we're not too far, probably 400 yards or so away from where we first started, so we're in pretty good shape. At least for now. Again, the only 100% way to disinfect your water is to boil. The only way. Just take my metal container, throw it in the fire, and should be good. Have some fresh water to drink. Might even make a tea. So our water is done. We'll get that out of there. Set it off to the side for now. So our water is done. We got some pretty good firewood right here for the night. Still got some small stuff. And again, there's plenty around me, so I'm not overly concerned with wood for the night. And hopefully it's not going to get too cold, but I think I have what I need for the night. So now I got to start focusing on what I have in mind to do is go out on a little scout, see if I can find some food, and probably set a couple traps, two or three anyway, see if I can have, you know, something to eat for tomorrow as well as tonight. I'll see if I can hunt something, you know, small game for dinner tonight. I've got maybe a week's worth of food if I'm lucky, in the way of, you know, some flour, some pancake mix, some oatmeal, and some beef jerky and stuff like that. So that'll be it for tonight if I get skunked on this little scout, and hopefully we can set a few traps and have some food for tomorrow. It's gonna be an ongoing thing from here on out. It's day one. I'm already talking about hunting and trapping again, because I have about a week's worth of food, and we know food's very important. So if I'm gonna make it out here a year, I'm gonna have to eat. So we're just gonna let this fire die down a little bit so I don't leave it unattended. I'm gonna get out, set a couple of those traps, try to do that. It's gonna be beef jerky and some type of bread. Well, the rain's coming in. Haven't been gone, you know, 5-10 minutes. So I'm back here. We've seen a bunch of those fiddlehead ferns in that marshy, swampy area. I'm thinking I'm gonna set a trap or two down here, probably try to get a coon or a possum. So definitely gotta be on our game now. Get wet, come tonight. Again, hypothermia, not too far away. Make for a miserable night, and we gotta get back in time to make sure we can keep our fire going. So we'll head down here and set a couple traps. Alright, so I'm thinking right here is probably a good spot for a set. What I'm thinking, that stream that we're not too far away from our camp, I believe, is the same stream here. So your possum and your coons are gonna come down by the water's edge, you know, as well as everything else, but more particularly them, looking for something to eat. So right in this little crook of the tree, I'm gonna throw some bait. I'm gonna set my trap right here in this trap bed I kind of just kicked out for now. I've got my wire tied up to secure my trap with, and I will go from there. So let's get this trap in the trap bed and get it baited. There's a lot of different types of traps. I prefer an MB myself, for the leg holds anyways. Just tie it off to my wire over here. Just anchor it to the tree. What else is good about these type of traps? They're a little on the expensive side, but they got what's called a night latch. So at night, you don't have to fiddle around with the dog here under your pan to see if it's level or not, or see if it's right. Set it as a hair trigger or whatever. You just push this down under the loose jaw so it doesn't catch your finger. Push that down till it clicks, and you're good. We'll bury this in here as best we can. I don't have to have these. I don't have a lot of trapping supplies with me. Just a few traps, because I think it's that important to carry traps. But it just covers the pan. That allows you to sift some dirt over it to cover it up. And no dirt gets under the pan, so when the animal steps on it, it goes off. Usually there's a sifter to do this. Again, when you're coming out for a year long, there's only so much you can carry, so. I didn't think that was that important that I had to have it. So we're just gonna have to make do. Grab some of this, kind of funnel them in if we can, just a little bit so he wants to step.
You can
there.
See on both sides, it put some sticks, some dirt, that's just called fencing, so the animal, it makes the animal want to come in here, path of least resistance.
I'm just going to bait this hole up here. With some sardines. I brought two cans of sardines with me. Just for this, not much in the way of bait, but I'm hoping this gets me going, and as I catch animals, hopefully that'll give me more bait. So, nice fishy smell. I should bring in the coon and the possum for sure.
I'll go rinse this out by the creek, take it back with us.
So you can see I put a couple more sticks in the front. Usually I don't do this because when I'm typically trapping, I have the tools, like I said, to make that nice, dig the proper holes. But I don't have all that jazz. I just have traps, some trapping wire, and a little bit of bait. So I put some sticks blocking the entrance way to that little hole, which is going to cause the animal to have to work my set a little bit more. And hopefully get caught in my trap. Well, we got three traps set out. Nothing on the hunt. I didn't hunt too much. I was getting kind of worried about the rain, so I wanted to get back, at least get some traps set. I'll have to eat what I have with me for tonight. So, fire is obviously out, so I'm gonna have to get that going again. I'm just gonna sit down and relax for a while and take it from there. So I figured while I was relaxing here, I took a few things out of my pack to show you guys some of the things I have without digging too much out. So for tools, what I typically carry on me and what I use that I think is very helpful, obviously a good axe, especially come winter time, but you know, this can help you do a lot of things. Build a more permanent camp when the time comes, when you find the right place. I have a small folding saw, you know, for smaller type tasks. That comes in handy for making primitive fire sets, to building shelter, to helping with firewood, the whole bit. I have a bigger bow saw that's wedged down in the back of my pack that I didn't feel like digging out at the moment, but I have that as well for, you know, cutting some bigger trees down. And again, useful for the same things, just bigger trees. After that, of course, you know, I always carry a knife on my hip, but I like to carry several knives, and it's not to come out here and be Rambo, you know, that's not the idea behind it. Some people just love knives and like to carry a lot. I have a reason for that, and I like to think of it as task-specific tools. So, you know, some people think, you know, one knife will do everything for you. I tend to totally disagree with that. I think one knife can do a lot of things for you, but it's not made to do everything. And that's why there's different types of knives. So I have a small Mora here. That's, you know, a bushcraft style knife. It's good for carving, notching, stuff like that. You know, camp type stuff, bushcraft type stuff. I have a custom knife that was made for me by a good buddy of mine. It's stainless steel, and it's a skinning knife. That's exactly what it was made for. It's got some red hardwood, some bone, some leather work into the handle. Very nice knife. So hopefully when we get some game here, we'll better use that and skin it out. I got another smaller knife. This is, you know, more for trapping, same idea, skinning. It is carbon steel, so it's pretty rugged, but its intended purpose is for skinning and cleaning game as well. Next one that I like, good old fillet knife. It's hard to beat that knife for filleting fish. You could probably get by with one of these other knives, but you're not gonna fillet a fish like you will with this one. So I like to have one of those as well. And hopefully fish is gonna be a pretty regular part of my diet throughout the summertime. If I can do some getting through the ice in the winter, I'll surely try that. I have a bigger, you know, survival type knife, bushcraft, pretty much a one knife does all concept, but again, I don't believe in that. But this is just a big rugged knife, again, custom made for me, to my specs. So it's a good knife. I've used this for a couple years now, and it's never done me wrong. Attached to the sheath of this one is a ferro rod for affecting fire. Same concept behind this one as far as the ferro rod. always have one with me. This happens to be another custom knife that was made just for me, and it's a butcher style knife, again for skin and game and stuff like that. So task specific is what I believe in, so that's for the array of knives. The one on my hip is just a cheap old hickory butcher knife. I'm pretty fond of a butcher knife. It was used all over the frontier, and you know, it worked then, it worked for a couple hundred years then, and it still works now. So I like to carry that one, you know, quite often. So those are just some of the tools that I bring out with me that'll help me do the things that I need to do, you know, to survive out here. So figured again, while I was resting, I'd share that with you guys. So you know, there's only so much you can pack on your back to think you can come out here and, you know, live for a year. You kind of have to decipher what's most important to you, what's the most important priorities that you need to accomplish out here, and what's going to help you do that. So it's pretty nitpicky to try and figure all that out. I try to cover my basis going on, you know, the 6 survival priorities: fire, shelter, water, food, personal hygiene and first aid, and then navigation. In a survival scenario, you know, search and rescue would come into that and signaling, but I'm trying to be here and make it for a year, so I cover all my bases as far as that stuff goes. To include, you know, shelter isn't just a tarp, it isn't just some type of, you know, natural debris hut or something like that. It's part of the clothes on your back is your immediate shelter, so you gotta choose wise and accordingly there too. So I have some more things in my pack. As we go along here, I'll pull them out and show you why I brought them, what they're used for, why I thought they were important, things of that nature. But one thing I wish I had was some sort of conveyance so I didn't have to carry all this stuff. And quite frankly, I could have brought more, because you definitely need more than you can pack in your back. Reminds me of a couple stories I'd like to share with you while we're hanging out by the campfire, you know, waiting to get something to eat here and then going to bed. So I think you'll enjoy it. So this reminds me of a couple stories, actually documentaries that, you know, I've watched in the past several times over. Dick Prenicky is one of them. He lived up in Alaska, built his own cabin, and all with hand tools, you know, chisels, hand saws, the whole bit. And it took him a couple years to do that. He went out the first year, cut down all his logs, peeled them, stacked them up until he could come back the next year and start building his cabin. So when he went back and started building, he had the opportunity or the luxury of staying in somebody else's cabin. In the film, it shows him canoeing across, you know, the river or the lake to get to where he was building his cabin. So I guess my point is, he had a means of conveyance, a means to bring everything he needed out there. He mentioned in the documentary of this being his third trip of bringing gear out. So again, he had a way to bring everything he needed out there. He wasn't just packing it all on his back, you know, whatever you can fit in a backpack and going. But he lived out there for quite some time. His cabin's still there today. I think it's a tourist attraction now, and you can actually visit it. Another one is Hemo and Edna Korth, who also live, you know, far up in Alaska, I think close by the Arctic Circle or something like that. Hemo Korth, Hemo started out as a butcher, basically, from my understanding. Worked in packing meat, and I had an opportunity to go up in Alaska and try to, you know, do this essentially. So he ended up marrying an Inuit woman, Edna, who ended up going with him, and you know, they did a lot of things together. Over the course of, you know, several years, they ended up with 3 cabins that they made, you know, and all kinds of resources. And again, the point to this is he had a way of conveyance. A lot of his stuff was flown in by bush plane. So he had, you know, 55-gallon drums full of dry goods and multiple rifles and shotguns. And he was an avid trapper. He actually trapped for fur. And that's what, you know, he paid with or traded for, you know, the food to eat and any needed supplies that he had. But again, he had conveyance to bring everything that he needed out there for him. So, you know, again, I think this is appealing to most people. It's certainly appealing to me. That's why I do it. It's more of a lifestyle for me than a hobby or anything. If I wasn't tied to society at the moment and had a family, you know, this is the way I want to live off-grid. So this will be a good stepping stone for me. Get some more learning experience and, you know, take that with me when the time comes to go ahead and do this. The wife's on board with it. She's a big supporter of mine. She supports me in everything I do, you know, for the most part. So she's all about it. We just got to wait for the little one to fly the coop one day, and hopefully at that point we'll be set up to where, you know, we can go ahead and do something like that.
So it's still raining pretty steady. So about that time I'm gonna have to get something in my belly. So I did actually have a couple packages of ramen noodles. That's a trail favorite for me. And I don't wanna pull out a whole bunch of stuff and get a bunch of things dirty. I'm just gonna boil some water in my cup for that. I also have the beef jerky that we mentioned. You know, I've tried throwing the beef jerky in with the ramen noodles and that's good. But I think I'll snack on that and eat the ramen noodles by themselves when they're ready. I'll get that water on the go and go snack on some beef jerky. It's incredibly warm right here. Peel off a layer. Mash them up so it fits in the cup when I'm ready. It's a pretty good living right here. Get something in one of them traps tomorrow. Be even better. You know, just as I shot that last scene, just behind us here, had a gobbler. He couldn't mend more than 50 yards or so. I didn't see him, but he was definitely close. He cackled a couple times. I thought we were gonna get lucky. I think that's why I like it so much out here, especially by yourself. You know, you're at nobody's mercy. You ain't on anybody's time clock. You and Mother Nature, that's it. Just follow her rhythm, you'll be all right. I haven't really talked about, you know, some of the dangers out here, other than hypothermia, I think I've mentioned a couple times. And that's one of the three killers. But around here, you know, there's lots of wild game. Catch a moose at the wrong time in the rut, and that could definitely prove tragic. So they're around, and I gotta be aware of them. It's not currently the rut, but they're here. You know, and you got your coyote, your bobcat. Pretty sure there's lynx in the area. And I don't worry so much about those, because as long as they know you're here, you'll probably never even see them. And then you have black bear.
which could obviously ruin your day pretty quick. On this area, at least, hear them turkeys again. So according to my research in this area, they figure about 4,800 to 5,000 black bear across New Hampshire. And they figure it's about an average of one per square mile. But obviously that's just an average, so they're more densely populated in some areas opposed to others. So I definitely got to be cognizant of them as well. I think the last known or documented black bear attack in New Hampshire anyway was in 1748 or something like that. So, you know, the chances are slim, but I don't know how they get their statistics, if that's just off of people, you know, going to the White Mountains on a summer trip or a hike, something like that, then there's not a whole lot of opportunity to run into the bear to begin with. When you're living out in their backyard, it's a whole lot different. Well, I think our water's done for our ramen noodles, so let's go ahead and get that. Tell you what, them turkeys are antagonizing me over here. Might just have to go take a walk. Definitely getting dark, but I can still see quite a ways. Grab the gun here in a minute. See if I can go get them. Put that ramen shape up. Did you hear that? He's close. Wasn't the best hen cackle in the world. But he's definitely close. Probably letting everybody know where he's at. He's just about to roost. It's a good sign. Couple more pieces of this beef jerky. I don't want to eat too much. It's the only bag I have. Tear into them ramen noodles. Get something warm in my belly. Oh, it's going to be R&R after that. I'll tuck in and call it a night.
Alright. Ramen it is. And call it a night. Now this isn't just a favorite woods meal for me. I like this a lot at home too. Pretty good stuff. Haven't heard any more gobbling back there, so he's probably up in the tree by now. Good to know he's around though, for sure. Hoping this rain stops. I'm not a big fan of rain at all. I'd rather have 6 feet of snow than rain. Hot spark. Another good thing about wool, a wool sweater, a couple wool blankets, don't have to worry about that stuff too much. Ultralight style, ultralight backpacker type stuff, and I'd have holes all in my stuff already. Night one, you know, that wouldn't be a good thing. We eat this every day. Unfortunately, that's not gonna happen. I got one left. And 364 more days to go. Have to put that away. Keep the critters away. It's about time to turn in. So, thinking back on the two documentaries I talked about, from Demo Korth and Dick Pernicke, and having a way of conveyance to bring everything that you need out to wherever it is you're going to be. Can you actually make it a whole year with just what you can pack on your back? We'll just have to see.